come to order. Regular meeting of the Town of Courtside Common Council for Tuesday, August 13, 2024 is now in session. Please stand and join us. Councilmember Warner will give the invocation, followed by Vice Mayor Goldberg leading us in the pledge.
Give us the vision to see what is right. Give us the wisdom to choose it, and give us the strength to make it happen.
Amen.
Join me in honoring the flag of the United States of America.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Will the clerk please call a roll?
Mayor Simpson?
Here.
Vice Mayor Goldberg?
Here.
Councilmember Warner?
Here.
Councilmember Bearcat?
Present.
Councilmember Ammon? Councilmember Rosner?
Item number one, call to the public, announcements and communication from citizens. Any members of the community wishing to speak? Seeing none, we'll close, call to the public, bring it back. Move on to presentations, proclamations, and reports. Item two, summer program presentation by Community Center Coordinator Jewel Raspberry Elam.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I am Jewel Raspberry Elam, and this is our head volunteer, Jack Barber. We are here to do a short presentation on our summer program. We wanted to let you know that we did, our theme was the Magical Passport. And on the video, you'll get to see some of the things that we did, along with the visits that we had from the Phoenix Herpetological Sanctuary and the Arizona Science Center. Please enjoy.
comments, at least. I thank you and Jack for that presentation. I have four generations of family living in town here, and sometimes we just need something like that to bring us back down to earth and show us what's really important. So thank you very much.
How many kids did we have?
We had 53 registered children, and then on the first day we had 18, and that was June the 3rd, and on July the 18th, the last day, we had 30 that attended that day.
That's great.
Anyone else have any comments, questions?
Keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Thank you, Jack. Item number three, new transit employee presentation by transit manager Jan Collier.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Jan Collier, Transit Department. So we have two new employees in this department. We have April, our backup driver, and we have Gordon, our part-time fill-in driver.
Okay, well, welcome, and good to meet you both, and hope you have a long stay at Quartzsite and long drive employment for the town. So, welcome to Quartzsite.
So the very next time that there are transit presentations, it will be Melissa doing the presentations.
Okay. Thank you, Jan. Item four. Employee recognition by Deputy Manager Kiki Connell.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. With Janet just announcing her last employees, we also want to give recognition to her today, as her last day of employment with the town will be on Friday the 16th. She is retiring after 12 years. In service with the town of Quartzsite, starting at the front counter clerk, moving on to the transit manager position in 2014. That's where she stayed, and we appreciate your time that you've done with your department and with the town of Quartzsite. We appreciate you.
Thank you. Speech.
You thought it was your last time, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
What did she get?
Beautiful.
Send around.
I would just like to say thank you.
Bear will just consider it something to dust off.
Can you get him to do that for me? That would be awesome.
I got to say, that's the largest diamond I've ever seen.
I know, isn't it cool? Anyways, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for what you've done, keeping the transportation going all these years.
Thank you, Janet.
I hope you don't really retire to volunteer for something now. She's having to work.
Thanks. The Parks Cultural and
Tourism, all kinds of things.
Do we put her name in on that one too? Okay, let's move on to item five, employee recognition by Public Works Director Emmett Breakerhoff.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Emmett Breakerhoff, Public Works Director. I just wanted to bring three employees here tonight to give them some special recognition for 5 years of service or more. So the first one I'll start off with is Nikki Collier. A little about Nikki. I just want to say that she's a real team player. We need this in Corsite. She helps in all departments. She's my right-hand woman. She helps me with everything I do, even ordering these. She helps.
Does that sign go on her marketplace?
Go wherever she wants to put it. But also, in any task that she is given, she will get it done. She now manages the parks and facility maintenance departments, and she's doing a great job at that. Congratulations on 5 years, and keep on going.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next one we have is Lon Curtis. He's actually had 6 years of service. A little about Lon. Lon is the water guru for the town. He takes care of everything for the town. He takes care of 1,000+ meters in town. Takes care of both the COFA and Quail Trail well. Does the monthly and yearly samples. Does the monthly meter reads. He does the new water and sewer connections. And he takes care of all the work orders. Turns on, turn offs, hydrant meter installs on a daily basis. Lon is also equipment operator and a CDL holder, so he helps out in all departments with running equipment. He's on call every other weekend. And he has been doing all these tasks on his own for the last 4 months. So I just like to thank Lon for all your hard work, 6 years of service, and thank you.
Thank you.
No, good, thank you. All right, save the longest for the last. Jesse Newton, he actually started with the town in February 5th, 2007, so he now has 17 years of service with the town. Jesse maintains and operates 85 pieces of equipment. That's the police department, public works, transit, water, wastewater, parks, administration, all, and numerous other pieces of equipment like little generators, whackers, everything else. And Jesse not only does the services, but he also does full motor transmission replacements on his own. So he only didn't ask for help with pulling motors, transmissions, anything. Jesse is also a master fabricator, welder. Anything that needs to be built, he is the man to do it. Jesse is also an equipment operator and a CDL holder. He helps anytime that we need help in the field with cleanups or anything else. He's always there to help. Congratulations, Jesse. We're going every 5 years. So I'm going to try and keep up on this now.
Jesse, anything? No, I'm good.
Thanks, Evan.
Thank you.
Evan, before you sit down, and you do have some of your staff here, I just want to say congratulations to your department for the quick response, cleanup, and still smiling from that storm that we had over the weekend.
Yeah, no, they do a fantastic job every time.
Yes.
It's unbelievable what a small crew can get done in a quick amount of time.
Well, and they all work together. Yeah. That's the neat thing.
We're all one team.
I wanted to say that while some of them were here.
You need to get together with your folks so that Brian can take a picture for them.
Yeah. Thank you. Do a quick picture now?
Yes, real quick.
No, tomorrow.
I know you're not going to hang around long.
That's an order.
Well, that's not fair.
Here, let me put this up here. Yeah.
Where do you want it at?
Yep.
Right there.
That'll work.
Come
on, scoot in. Are they right side up? Yay! Cheddar cheese. Thank you. Good job.
Okay, we'll move on to the consent agenda. Consent agenda is a list of items believed to be non-controversial. All items will be acted upon with one motion. any item can be separated for separate motion and action by any council member. Item 6A, ledger of accounts paid. Consider approval of accounts payable check series number 52399 through 52415, number 52425 through 52442, totaling $456,811.61, and payroll check series paid number 52416 through 52424, totaling $91,251.74, for a grand total of $548,063.35. And item 6B, minutes. Consider approval of the following town council meeting minutes from work session of July 23rd, 2024, and the regular meeting of July 23rd, 2024. And item 6C, approval of fiscal year 2025 engagement letter for professional consulting services with Heinfield Beach & Company, PC, and approving town manager Ferguson to sign the letter. Are there any corrections to the minutes?
I'd like to have a statement from the town manager. Reading the contract, we talked about that.
If you want to pull it, and then we can talk about it. You had some questions regarding it?
Liability?
On the letter, yeah. That would be better if we just pulled it.
Okay, we'll pull it.
Yeah.
Which?
6C. 6C. Okay. 6C will be pulled, so we're looking for a motion on 6A and 6B, if there are no corrections to the minutes on 6B.
Mr. Mayor, I'll make a motion to approve the consent calendar item 6A and 6B as stated.
Second.
We have a motion by Vice Mayor, seconded by Council Member Warner to approve the item 6A and 6B. On the consent calendar as presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Motion carries. 6C?
Yes, I've spoken with our deputy town manager regarding this. She's worked with Heinfeld Beach now for quite some time. And the reason we put her on the consent is because we've done this so many times. But I know there was a question. And actually, I'd like, Kiki, if you would, to explain it so there's a better understanding of what our relationship is here and how we use them.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Kiki Tanow, Deputy Manager. Heinfeld and Meach, we've been with them, well, they've been helping consulting with us for several years. The majority of the time was they would help also administer day-to-day tasks. Now, that's not true as far as the last probably 5 years. They mainly do a lot. They provide advice and recommendations for us to follow, for myself to discuss with management as a whole, the town manager. They do audit preparations for us to prepare us for our audits, helping us look at our general ledger, reviewing that to make sure that my balances are true and fact balanced. And if there's any questions and what they recommend, like, oh, maybe you should have done it this way versus, you know, and then review whenever the audit is done, then we again go through it and say, okay, we could have done this better this last year. So they just help me as just preparing for our audits. And anything, we haven't used them, like I said, in a while to do any other financials to help us. Like if there was a big project that we used to do, I know that when we were doing WIFA years ago, they helped too, to make sure that everything was accounted for, documented for the audit preparation so that everything was in balance, the interest, the principal, everything like that as well, working with different vendors. So that's what they mostly are used before, and I can tell you, years ago, we were paying anywhere from $50,000 to $30,000. And as you see on the cover sheet, we're about anyway, we range from $5,000 up to $10,000 in the last like 3 years. So we don't use them as much as far as any financial, but again, they are there for advice and recommendations. But we still have to have the internal controls. We are still liable for what we do, and that's why we have those internal controls in place. And that's what our auditors look at as well. So even if we have a consultant, they review those as well, what their audits and what their recommendations are. And but again, we follow our management internal controls. So, and then again, we may be advised, we advise them on certain matters that are related. So I wouldn't go above and beyond the scope unless I spoke with the town manager. But other than that, they just help with preparation. That is it.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, my question on this is, reading through this contract, they have no liability. If they make a mistake, they give you bad advice, there's nothing that the town can do about it except take the bad advice and have a bad outcome. So how are we going to remedy that?
Well, with that, I mean, again, it's just advice. And that is why then I would not just take that advice and just run. It's not just me solely. I would then talk with, it could be with Jim, obviously, or any man, whatever the purpose is, whatever that is, the, you know, what they're asking or what they're saying that you should do. I would then, and some of the things I have done is consult even our auditors on certain things to see if those are correct in ways that we're doing.
If our attorney gives us bad advice and we follow it, it's back on him because he gave the advice. If this organization gives you advice and it turns out bad, it doesn't fall back on them for giving bad advice and guidance.
Is there no errors and omissions insurance?
Well, I'm sure that they would have that type of insurance, but I think the important thing to understand is the difference in the role between the town attorney and this organization. They are there because of the expertise that they have in terms of understanding the processes, okay? The liability, responsibility, it lies with us, okay? We have the ultimate responsibility. I get advice, you know, from different consultants frequently, half through my entire career. But it's up to me as to whether or not I follow it, if in fact statutorily or code-wise it's my responsibility. And so that's a little different than a town attorney. There's a defined responsibility that the town attorney has that essentially says, if I follow his advice, I'm going to be protected. If I don't, it's on me, you know. So it's a whole different kind of relationship than with HIPAA.
And it's different from other types of accounting relationships too. Like if I retain an accountant to do my taxes, he's responsible for the advice that he gives me. They're still responsible. It still says that they will perform the services in accordance with the applicable professional standards. If they were to do something that was grossly negligent outside of those professional standards, we would absolutely have a cause of action to go against them to try to recover whatever damages might have occurred because of that. But they're not providing a very specific, we're doing an audit or we're doing this, to where they would have those professional liability responsibilities for those specific items.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, I think that is good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, item 6C.
With that being said, I'll make a motion to approve item 6C on the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion by Vice Mayor Goldberg, seconded by Council Member Warner, to approve item 6C as presented. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Move on to business. Item 7, K canvas of the 2024 primary election votes. Canvas of the votes of the July 30, 2024 primary election and possible adoption of resolution number 24-12 declaring and adopting the results of the primary election of July 30th, 2024. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor, council members, and for the public, the process of canvassing, I think a lot of times it becomes confusing in terms of what the boards can do. The process is one to simply memorialize, if you will, what the outturn of an election was through a governing body. You're the governing body that needs to do that for this particular election that we're talking about here as it relates to the town council election positions that were voted on. The results that you've received, note that for mayor, a four-year term, that we had no formal opposition in the election. Norm Simpson, being the incumbent, also received 409 votes out of 431 that were cast. There were 22 write-in votes. There were undervotes of 82. Now, essentially, when they talk about undervotes, they're saying that overall there were so many people that voted, okay, but some of them didn't vote for mayor, okay. That's all that really means. So the contest total, there were 513 that voted in the mayoral portion, or had the option to vote. In the council member, we had three seats for council member, four-year terms. Nancy Nichols was the top vote getter with 372. Carrie Ammon followed with 287. Star Bearcat followed with 247. Again, there were some write-ins. Total votes cast were 953. There were a number of undervotes. That simply means that they might have voted only for two of them, or they only one of them. People had that option. They had the option to vote up to three. Okay. So that is what we have received from the county in terms of the election results. The rest of the language is just explaining that further, and with all the whereas clauses. Do you have any questions on that at all? It's pretty straightforward.
Questions?
Have any questions?
Okay. This is action item.
I make a motion to adopt resolution number 24-12 declaring and adopting the results of the primary election held on July 30th, 2024.
Second. Second.
Thank you. Okay, we have a motion by Councilmember Warner, seconded by Councilmember Bearcat, to adopt resolution 24-12 declaring and adopting the results of the primary election held on July 30th, 2024. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries. Congratulations.
Yes, congratulations.
Thank you. So when does Nancy get sworn in?
Item number 8, COFA Avenue Path Project. Discussion and consideration to approve the bid award for the COFA Avenue Path Project to DPE Construction Incorporated. Hammond, go ahead.
Good evening, Mayor, Council, and everybody around. And we recently went to bid on the Copa Avenue Pathway Project, which is up on your screen for the location of the pathway. We actually received four bids, and they ranged from $275,000 to $601,000. So you can see it up there. The darker black line up on the screen, that will be where the pathway starts and ends. It starts at the AWC College, and it will terminate on Tyson Street for the first phase. Next slide. So this is just kind of a typical section of the plans. Next one. Yeah, you see it there, starting at the college driveway, where it'll be coming off the existing pathway. It'll be a 10-foot pathway that runs down all the way along the road. It'll be a meandering pathway with decomposed granite that separates between the pathway and the pavement. It's all pretty much the same all the way down through there. If you want to skip to the next one, it goes down, crosses Saguaro, Pyramid, Camel, and pretty much terminates right there at Tyson Street for now.
Any questions?
And we checked all the references on DPE, and this is, they're plenty capable of doing this project. This is actually probably a pretty small project for their firm, so they'll be able to get it done. If I do notice of award tomorrow, they'll be ready to start going in September, and it'll be completed by early October.
Will this pathway be strong enough to withstand the ATVs, the trucks, the cars that park and drive on?
Yeah, the pathway is actually constructed with 2 inches of AC pavement, which is
$275,000.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilmember Warner, seconded by Councilmember Bearcat, to accept the bid and approve a contract with DPE Construction Incorporated for the COFA Avenue Path Project in the amount of $275,000. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
All right. Thank you, Mayor and Council.
Thank you.
All right, just to add to it, we budgeted $300,000. It came in $25,000 under budget. So.
Tell DPE. All right. Number 9, 2024 League Resolution Committee. Discussion on resolutions to be considered at the 2024 League Resolution Committee meeting and possible action or direction for each resolution's approval or disapproval by Quartzsite Town Council members who serve on the committee.
Thank you, Mayor and Council members, and once again for the public as well, because many of them are not familiar with this process. Arizona League of Cities and Towns is a very important organization to communities in the state of Arizona, and especially for those of us who are much smaller and do not have the staff to be able to go and lobby on a continuous basis for one of the larger issues to write legislation, that type of thing. That's just one of the areas. There's many of them, training, education, all of that. But this is one of those areas where annually they form committees and review issues that are of importance to different communities. Sometimes it'll be a number of communities to present an idea. Sometimes it'll be just one community. That doesn't mean, however, that that one community necessarily gets that issue placed before the legislature, because the process is to take it first to the committees that are formed by the league. Those committees then review those items and issues and determine whether or not they have importance to all cities and towns or the majority of cities and towns. And it's done by the committee process. Each of you have had the opportunity to serve on these different committees and to give input and to take action within that committee. And that's where it is today. These are the final resolutions that have gone through the committee process and have been approved to to the extent that they will go to the Resolutions Committee. So there's another review process, and that is simply all of the towns in one big meeting, and we have our representative, the Vice Mayor Boulder, who's been asked to serve there by the mayor. The mayors typically are the ones who are given the first option there, but not all the mayors serve. Many of them do appoint others to serve in that capacity. What we have added, and not all communities do this, but I think it's a good process. What we have added is to talk about them as once they're finalized, and at least give a vote of support one way or the other as to whether or not we think our representative, Vice Mayor Boulder, should vote in support of or against the issue. It's interesting to see these items come before that Resolutions Committee at the League, because they're not always rubber stamped. You get some pretty heavy discussions at times. But I think what you're doing as a council and what the public needs to do is you are engaged in the process of determining whether or not certain legislation should take place that would benefit our community as well as other communities in the state. If they're approved at the League, then they become part of the process for working with the state legislature to make the kinds of changes that are suggested here. So that's where we're at. I don't know that we necessarily need each individual committee report. You've all had the opportunity to review the resolutions packet. If you have questions, probably that's the better place to start as to whether you have any objections or questions to the resolutions that have been presented to us.
Just for the public's, I was just going to go through what the committees are. The different, we have budget, finance, and economic development, general administration, human resources, and elections, neighborhood sustainability and quality of life, public safety, military affairs, and the courts, and transportation, infrastructure, and public works. Those are the committees, the different committees that cities and towns serve on and bring forward resolutions, proposals for resolutions that then go through their committee, as Mr. Ferguson explained, then at League of Cities and Towns, at the Resolution Committee, each town or city is called upon to vote on each one of the resolutions that are brought forward. Then at the last day of the general meeting, general assembly, they bring that up again, and the whole cities and towns do another vote. So that's kind of how it all works. So how do you want to do this?
That list you have, if we go through it one by one,
it's up to you if you want to do one by one, or is everybody comfortable? Does anybody have any questions or concerns about any of them?
I guess the public might like to know what each one of those seven are
what
it's about.
Yeah, that way, if we went over just what you've got there in front of you on each one of them, then we vote on them one at a time.
Okay. Loretta, do you want to read yours, your budget, finance, and economic development?
Is it one or two?
It's two.
Number two, BFED two?
Yeah, BFED one and two.
Okay, the first one that I have, and this is under the budget committee, and all those other person. The first one is proactively seek solutions to offset losses of funds resulting from the rental tax repeal and preserve current revenue stream. This was introduced by the town of Goodyear. And in English, what that means is that there is a tax that is a part of our model city code which is a code that all towns and cities can subscribe to. There are certain selections in there. You get to choose which selection works for you as a town for sales tax purposes. This particular one of the options in the model city code is a residential rental tax. And some towns have used that residential rental tax to recover some of their lost revenue from COVID. The state of Arizona governing body of the state of Arizona is wanting to repeal that and take it out of the model city code. This resolution says, no, leave it in. That's what this one is about. The second one for, is there any questions about that one? Okay. The second one is work the state partners to authorize municipalities to use tax increment financing. This one is a little confused. Apparently, Arizona is the only state in the union, according to their promotion, that does not allow the developer to, on undeveloped or underdeveloped property, the town cannot impose a tax on the future value of underdeveloped or undeveloped property. In other words, if the value of the property now is $100,000, but the development isn't going to be finished for 5 years, they can actually go in and tax what they think that value of that town is going to be in 5 years. And this is apparently a development tool that is used across the country in every other state but Arizona. And so this is a promoting, and it was submitted by the town of Surprise. It's promoting allowing that.
Correct. That, and it's true, most states have had it for many years. I used tax increment financing in Utah 40 years ago. And it's always been one of those issues where Arizona communities found themselves not as competitive as other states because they could use tax increment financing to enhance the incentives that they could give to a new industry. So, not to say that Arizona doesn't have others, but tax increment financing is used almost everywhere.
So those were the two I had.
General Administration, Human Resources, and Elections, I think that was Devin. So one of them was clarify statute to authorize the Secretary of State and municipal clerks to enforce strict compliance of all constitutional and statutory requirements for referendums. The second one, and I was not in on those meetings, so I don't...
That one was a result of a recent court case where, I think it was City Surprise, where they submitted petitions for a referendum that clearly didn't comply with the statutory requirements, but the clerk wasn't authorized to reject them. So it had to go through the process, go through the votes, get contested, go through lawsuits, and all that rigmarole. And this is to provide essentially to provide the clerk with the authority to say that doesn't meet the statutory requirement, it cannot be approved and it can be rejected. Okay. And then if they have an objection to it being rejected, they have a court process where they can go and seek court intervention on an expedited basis to have it put on the ballot.
But the referendum is not a free item. The town has to pay for that referendum, and if it's going to be rejected because it doesn't meet qualifications, this allows them to do it up front.
Right, because there's a lot of cost and expense that goes into what the town has to do to pay for that the publicity pamphlet and all that goes into a referendum process that the town has to, town and city has to pay for.
The second one is lift the prohibition on candidates for local office from transferring campaign funds to allow for equal treatment among candidates and encourage candidates with local experience to run for higher office. And this would allow candidates for local office to transfer campaign contributions to another campaign, a candidate committee, should they choose to instead pursue statewide or legislative office. So if somebody decides they want to run for a higher office than a local office, they, and there's money left in their campaign, they can transfer that to that individual that wants to run for a higher office.
But it stays with that person.
Right.
So when Councilmember Bearcat decides to run for governor, she can take the big campaign financial contribution she has in her council committee and transfer that over to her governor.
Right.
Jinxing my campaign.
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to let the cat out of the bag.
Okay, the next one is mine. Restore local control to allow the establishment of local policies to incentivize the development of attainable and below-market housing. Housing is a major, major issue in almost every committee. The purpose of this one was repeal ARS 9-461, 1-16, to allow municipalities to enact tailored policies that can spur the development of an investment in a supply of housing that is accessible to low to moderate income individuals and families. There's so many restrictions. You know, the cities, our cities and towns, they're all dealing with housing shortages. And so League of Cities and Towns and these individual cities are all trying to come up with ways to change some of the rules, some of the state rules that would allow them to encourage development for, we call it workforce housing, not necessarily the low-income housing. And that was brought forward by Tempe, I think. Yeah, Tempe. Next one.
It's mine. bear with me. Clarify statute to apply immunity only to claims arising from a public employee's operation of a motor vehicle and affirm that the statute is a immunity statute. What this is about is there's been third-party people using municipality equipment, and they're trying to claim immunity for when they make a mistake. And this is to clarify the statute so that it's only for the employees, not for a third party. The next one is allow public bodies to withhold records that could identify a victim or a witness to a crime if there is a reasonable belief they will be subjected to harassment. And what this is about is apparently there's nothing on the books to blackout or redact witnesses, and people have had crimes against them on public record request. And in order to help protect those witnesses, they're asking for it to be on the books that it can be redacted for safety of the witnesses and people that had crimes against them.
And there's one other one that I'm gonna, this did not get brought forward, and this is transportation infrastructure and public works. The Prescott mayor brought forward the idea that a user fee, that the state should establish a user fee for electric vehicles. right now, our HERF funds are being hurt because there are a lot of electric vehicles on the road. And right now, there is no tax on those charging stations. So Prescott, the mayor in Prescott, brought this forward. The league folks decided that they were not going to bring it forward this year, but they want to do some additional research, gather additional information, and then possibly bring it forward next year. But I thought that was interesting. That
yeah, and the argument there is that you have so many electric vehicles who are using and putting wear and tear on roadways, but they're not contributing to those funds that pay for that through gas taxes or even registration taxes. You can register an electric vehicle for $25, and you don't get those any taxes, but they still put the same type of wear and tear on a roadway that a regular gas car should.
I just thought that was important to bring forward. Anyway, so tell me how y'all want to vote, folks.
Well, mine is pretty consistent with whether it affects us or not. We've run for the general participants of the league on most of these things. Does anyone have a problem with any of them or disagreement with the approval of any of these?
Yeah, the two that I have really don't affect Quartzsite. Maybe the residential, but we haven't changed our tax code in the 10 years that I've been on, so I don't look for us to do that anytime soon. But that would probably be the only one that in the future might impact the town of Quartzsite. The other one, I don't know that it might with development and so forth, but right now neither one of them do. But as far as I'm concerned, we should support our neighboring communities. So I'd say yes on both of those.
Tax increment financing, just to answer that, is one of those things that if your neighbor has it, you need to have it. So if more towns around us were to adopt tax increment financing, it would then be incumbent for Quartzsite to consider it. What needs to be understood is that that's an overall benefit to the economy, not something that comes necessarily out of the local taxpayers' pockets. It's the development that has to pay for it.
So, me.
Councilmember, is there anything? Are you good with everything?
I'm good.
Okay.
Action requested direction to Vice Mayor Goldberg for League of Cities and Town resolution submission for 7 resolutions. So, if somebody want to make a motion to
they're just giving me
Vice Mayor direction.
Just a motion to forward Vice Mayor direction to support the 7 resolutions.
To support it. So all 7.
Make a motion to give Vice Mayor
Goldberg.
Linda.
Okay.
Direction for the 7.
Second.
Mayor, while she is not here and therefore cannot vote, I would still like to make sure you all understand that Carrie Ammon did review all of these, and she said that she would be present to vote aye on all.
Thank
you.
All right. I have my orders.
Okay. We have a motion by Councilmember Bearcat, seconded by Councilmember Warner, to give direction to Vice Mayor Goldberg to approve, carry our vote on all 7 as yes vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any nays? Any abstentions? Motion carries.
Thank you.
This was marked invitation for public comment. My mistake, I should have brought that up. Is there, in this last item, is there anyone that has any questions on what we were doing and why? Okay. We'll
close public comment after the fact. Okay, we'll move on to communications. Item 10, report from the mayor on current events. Couple of things. We just went through the canvas of the vote here tonight, and there's a point that I got to bring up. So you understand a little more about the process. District 2 Supervisor Deuce Miner comes to most of our meetings here. He's one of the ones in the race. His three-way vote come down to three votes different. And as a result, had it been four votes different, it would have went to a new election, a runoff election. But because it was only three, it went back to a recount. The recount, they're just recounting the two main voters. Today, they had that recount. We won't know till tomorrow what the outcome is.
Thursday. They still have to recount on Thursday. And then Friday, we'll find out.
They started the count today.
Yep. They'll be back on Thursday.
Okay.
And then Friday, we'll get the information.
And the process is, after the recount, goes into a sealed envelope, goes to the judge, and the judge has to open the envelope and announce the outcome of the election. Now, that's one vote difference out of all the people in the county that voted on that. Now, when you think about it, it doesn't matter what party you are, if you vote for this person or this person, it's not one vote difference. It's two vote difference. If you vote for this person, you're taking away one vote there. So it comes out with a difference of two votes. Every one of these things that you vote on is important. And you may not think, well, this is county supervisor, we don't see him very often, so it doesn't really matter. It does. It makes a huge difference. So pay attention. The more you know and the more you understand who the nominees are, the better it is all the way around. You're not just picking a number or a name that sounds fancy or seeing who the incumbent is. You understand a lot more. Anyway, I wanted to bring that. This has been an ongoing problem in the past. Councilmember Amon was in a problem with one vote or two votes different. One vote makes a big difference, especially in a small community. And the next thing I need to bring up too, on current events, I had an opportunity to visit our emergency room this last week. I can tell you, I have a broken wrist. When people ask me, I have to tell them my parachute didn't open. Something that's glamorous, something that's worth talking about. The truth is, you've all heard the expression about civic servants or politicians. They're no different than we are. They put on one leg at a time, same way we do. That's what happened to me. I got out of the shower and I started putting pants on. I put the first leg in. When I went to put the second one in, it was knotted up. That second leg didn't go through. So I played pogo stick for a while until I fell over, crashed and burned. So these things happen. I'm sure most of us...
Most of us have had this happen at some time. So anyway, they did a good job at the emergency room.
Film at 11. It could be a fundraiser, you know.
That was more graphic.
Okay. Council, current events?
Couple things. I had the pleasure of serving on a committee that the County of La Paz is working on their general plan. They have not done a revision on their general plan since 2004, I believe it was. Yeah, they did. They had one in 2010, one addendum, but they are working on it. My role was in tourism. Tourism and agriculture are still the number one and number two industries of La Paz County, and they certainly recognize that tourism, how important tourism is. We talked a lot about our trails, about our weather, about our swap meets, shows, the different clubs and organizations that we have, and all the different activities that we have available in Quartzsite, as well as the entire county. We will have some county visits. They have not, the team has not really been out in the field that much, but they did share that they would want to eventually come in to the individual communities and have similar sessions to what we did when we were working on our general plan. So, and I think Mr. Ferguson will have some follow-up on that. The other meetings that I attended were through Arizona Office of Tourism. Our governor and the new director of tourism has decided that we need to kind of upgrade our branding for the state of Arizona. So there is two different consulting firms that they have, AOT has hired, and they are working on going out into the communities and having listening sessions, Zoom sessions, where they're talking about the pros and cons, what Arizona has to offer, what we don't have to offer, how do we want to be recognized. They have been out and met in Kingman, in Havasu, and in Yuma. And my question was, what happened to La Paz County? Well, we're going to get there. I was absolutely shocked that these consultants didn't even know what the Peace Trail, the Arizona Peace Trail, that goes through big time through La Paz County. So anyway, that is a ongoing project. I will. And again, this was as part of the La Paz Regional Tourism Team, of which the town of Quartzsite is a member. So I'll keep you updated on that. The other thing that I just want to mention, we were notified this afternoon, our business league has been trying to get some progress, action, if you will, from AWC. And lo and behold, next Thursday from 10 till 11 a.m., the 22nd, August 22nd, they will be doing a no-cost business counseling session. So as many folks as can, we really want you to attend. And I'm going to post, make sure that the Business League and the Chamber of Commerce gets, and the town maybe gets that flyer on our websites and get the information out. Other than that,
go ahead.
Okay, she's giving the fluffy stuff. I'm going to give you the hard stuff.
Okay.
The Boss County Sheriff put out a press release on Thursday, August 6th. the La Paz County Narcotics Task Force with the assistance of the La Paz County Special Response Team, Portside Police Department, and the Border Patrol executed a search warrant on a residence in Cousins Corner RV Park. The search warrant was a result of a thorough investigation led by detectives assigned to the La Paz County Narcotics Task Force. The target of this investigation was Lance P. Morgan. Lance was arrested on several counts of the sale and possession of dangerous drugs. During the execution of the warrant, Carl Ballward, I guess that's how you pronounce it, was located along with various other subjects. Carl was found to have an active felony warrant and taken into custody. Carl was also charged with possession of drugs and paraphernalia. And then it finishes with all accused are presumed innocent until proven guilty. And that's just part of what has been going on. The hard part is we've got elders and people that are not being treated well. And we've got some slum parks that need to have attention. Our citizens, we need your help. We need people to, when they see things, say things. If you're being harassed, we've got a court here that can help you out. We have a person that's willing to step forward and help you. We're a community. We need to help each other, and we need to clean up our parks and other things.
That's an agenda item.
I have one other announcement.
Wait a minute. Are you done?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Somebody in the room is celebrating their 21st birthday tomorrow. Mayor? 21, isn't that what you told me?
22.
Okay. Right. Happy birthday.
Oh, thank you.
Shall we sing?
Oh, no. Okay. No.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear mayor. Happy birthday to you.
Your turn's coming.
I don't have it anymore.
Let's arm wrestle.
Okay, go ahead.
There was also a summer fest at QES, which was an amazing event. This is the good news.
Yeah.
And as far as I know, they expect to have the school open by next school season. This one, they don't have the funding, so they've had to do something different. But the Summerfest was an amazing collection of information and happiness. Very joyful.
Good news.
Yep.
Good news. Okay, town manager.
Thank you, Mayor. Just a few things. One is to just note that virtually all of the projects that we've been talking about over the months are still moving ahead, just each one of them a little step at a time. Starbucks and the car wash are submitting for their drainage plan to be reviewed. So it's not uncommon for that to happen where they'll submit one portion of it at a time. And so it takes much longer than people realize to approve a project like that. Not that we're dragging our feet, they're just simply only submitting a portion. The initial reviews we typically have done by an outside firm, Wilden, currently. In fact, I've got two of them sitting in my door right now that came in today for further review, new projects. We continue to get inquiries. It's been really a very good year, in my opinion. Out of the last 8 years that I've been here, the number of inquiries that we're getting has increased significantly of projects that are interested specifically in Quartzsite for various reasons, mostly because they don't want to be in California, but there are other reasons. So I'm very happy with that. Clearly, I think we all know that businesses, just like we as individuals, they look at things that are going on in the economy and even the elections and all of those things, and that makes a little bit of difference in how they proceed and when they proceed. They look at the interest rates, but none of these have indicated to us that anything's putting a stop to their project. None of them. They all continue to make progress. So I'm very happy with that and happy to report it. Secondly, it's true that the comprehensive plan for the county, they did have different meetings with us. And I was very fortunate, quite honestly, because they set up a meeting with the town manager of Parker and myself. And she didn't show. So I got to talk about Quartzsite a lot. And I took advantage of it, too, and let them know the importance of the relationship with the county and the town down here that maybe they're not located in as an office. And even though we don't see them at lunch every day and commingle in other activities, we are equally important to the county, and I thought maybe even a little more so. And I let that be known. So if we had a good interchange of ideas, and I think it's going to be healthy for the county to entertain all these different thoughts. And it is true, and I chatted with them about it, they are going to be coming here, and they're going to be giving an opportunity for the public to engage as well in some of these discussions. So that's a good thing to hear. The second was related earlier, the wind damage that we had in town. I feel very bad for the individuals, and I know a number of individuals, residents that had a fair amount of damage. We too, as a town, especially in our parks area, had some fairly significant damage. We probably will be submitting some claims for some of the damage. Probably the thing that hit us the hardest was our outdoor stage that we have, and it was pretty much crashed. We're looking at other options, whether or not to rebuild, or perhaps now being the time to consider the acquisition of a new stage, and one that could be expanded upon, but that would serve us for a long time. So we're entertaining that, and I think Nikki set up a meeting for us on Thursday to review what our different options are in that respect. The other is not such great news in what happened today. The park has been opening on the splash pad for the second time. We had some good turnout at the pre-bid meeting, but we did not have a good turnout on the bid. We only had one firm bid. It's the same firm that gave the highest bid last time. Needless to say, since they were the only one to bid, they were still the highest bid. But the bad part about it is it's only $5,000 about difference in how they bid last time. Far more than what the town has in the way of funds available. We have $1 million, they were $1.7 million something. We will be coming back to the council regarding that with a proposal after we've had the opportunity talk to the state parks regarding the situation. We do not want to keep delaying this. We want to look at some other options to move ahead with the splash pad. But it is another example of what we as a town are up against in terms of making these projects happen. It's not all under our control. It just simply isn't. We have to depend upon the bidding process and those kinds of things. And in this case, twice now we've gone out, and the bids have come in much higher than what we could afford to do. The town can't afford to kick in $700,000 out of the general fund to make it happen. That would be ridiculous. we've looked at ways to scaling it down, but that maybe would not give us a project that our town would be happy with. If we were to just do a splash pad and none of the other, and we were to use the bid that came in today, that would use half our money. Just for the little area of the splash pad. That's how high their bid was. So trying to negotiate with the current bidder is somewhat questionable at this point in time. We haven't rejected it, but we're going to look at some other options. We'll be back to you on it. So the bid for the pathway was good. The bid today was not. So I just wanted you to be aware of that. Actually, that firm did chat with us about a portion of it, but they didn't bid.
Complete your report?
That completes my report.
So you weren't going to tell us if we're going to have a ribbon cutting for the new market in this fall? That's not scheduled.
They give us the authority to do that. We're still waiting on them to give us the word that they're ready for it. But we will be having one.
Okay, future agenda.
I was working pretty closely with a lot of people to try to get letters of support for the Proposition 402. And one of the biggest issues was the $75 fee that we charge to be able to publish that. So I would like to have on a future agenda that I don't want to reopen the whole fee schedule, but that one fee for publishing a ballot.
An amendment to?
I would like
you're proposing
to,
we have like a to. Meeting to consider an amendment to?
I'll concur.
What he said.
Yes. I'll concur.
Concur. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. You go ahead. I'd like to review the leak reimbursement policy that we have for our water. I think it needs to be reviewed. Most towns don't reimburse if somebody has a leak. We're about the only one that does. And we need to review that.
You said leak?
Leak, water leak.
Leaks, water leak.
Water leak. Water leak. I had one and it cost me extra money, but it came through my meter, so I paid.
You'll probably recall that as a council, you addressed this about 2.5-3 years ago.
Yeah.
And we established a procedure, written procedure, to make sure that we were handling everybody the same way. Bottom line is, we do something here in Forsyth that many communities don't, and that's what you're saying is you'd like to take a look at that again, correct?
Right.
So review it.
Review.
Not necessarily.
Right. Review.
Okay, I'll work on that.
Any other agenda? Seeing none. Having no further business to come before this council, we're hereby adjourned. Thank you all for coming tonight.
So glad you're here.
Well, just a reminder, no other meeting this month.
No other council meeting this month.
Right. Oh, there's no council meeting later in this month. We'll all be gone to the league conference.
What he was saying is the last council meeting in August will not be held because the majority of the council will be at League of Cities and Towns Conference.
Okay.